That's the perfect thing to do.
No, I've seen classes leave people.
This is real quiet.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Okay, if anybody's asking on live stream, we'll wait a minute or so here.
Then, in case you want to pay to the podcast.
I'm having the thing you told me about.
Yeah.
All right, we're gonna get started. Anybody comes in, well, that's just fine. It's just fine. Well, somebody must have hinted that we're gonna be talking about some strange things tonight because we got a room full here. And I'll grant you up front, yeah, this is gonna be a little unusual. And you're gonna get 4 weeks of that because what we're gonna talk about is gonna be pretty foreign to the way we think in a number of ways. So the purpose of doing this is just, like it says, to help you try to think like an Israelite. And this is going to be topical. So tonight we're going to talk about impurity and sin, you know, clean and unclean. And what I'm going to do is suggest to you, or kind of toss out, sort of where the state of best understanding is. This is a lot of strange stuff. We will have to think pretty abstractly to, you know, try to follow why in the world some of these, you know, laws and concepts are what they are in the Torah, in the Old Testament. And scholars have really kind of struggled to do that. So I'm going to present sort of what, again, what the consensus is currently as to what all this stuff means and why it is what it is. Next week, we'll talk about sacred space, which is going to tie in with this week. The week after that, we'll get into the actual sacrificial system, which will tie into the previous 2 weeks. And then the last week is a bit of mop-up and a bit sort of an appendix to the other three things. But if you are able to sort of grasp why, again, these concepts are what they are, they would actually help you through a lot of the Torah. Because a lot of the Torah is laws, it's sacrifices, it's rituals, and it's just kind of bizarre stuff. It carries through all the way to when you get a temple, tabernacle, and then a temple. And it will trickle into the New Testament in some kind of interesting ways, again, if you can sort of understand and follow conceptually how it is they're thinking. And it's going to be a little strange, it's going to be a little different. Now, for tonight, when we talk about impurity and sin, we're talking about cleanness and uncleanness. So we're going to start with impurity. This is, you know, if you've read through Torah, the first five books of the Old Testament, this is vocabulary that's going to be familiar. Don't do this, because if you do that, you'll be clean or unclean, and, you know, all these regulations and whatnot. There are actually two categories to an Israelite, you know, thinker, you know, someone who, again, would be a native experiencer of, you know, some of these things when you're living during a tabernacle period, when you're living, you know, during the time of the temples, when you're living in biblical days. There's actually two parts to this: ritual and moral. You can become ritually unclean. Okay, ritual has to do with what you as either a person, just an average Israelite, or a priest, what you can do in certain places and what you can't do in certain places, where you're allowed to go and not go in the camp in relation to the tabernacle or the temple. So ritual uncleanness is really about your participation, your eligibility or your ineligibility to do sacrificial stuff, to bring a sacrifice, to get your ritual, your uncleanness problem taken care of, or, you know, you have to wait X number of days before you can participate in this or that festival. All of that is about ritual impurity, ritual uncleanness. Fundamentally, it has nothing to do with a moral violation. Okay, there's no moral guilt. Now, having said that, there are a couple passages where if you do a moral transgression, lucky you, you're not put to death, but you may not be able to participate in the community. So there's a little bit of an overlap, but for the most part, ritual uncleanness is about participation in the whole system, in the community life. Whether that occurs on sacred space, and by sacred space I mean space that only God is supposed to occupy, or priests that are like God's substitutes, they're allowed to occupy that space or not. Okay. So again, some of these concepts we've already seen are related: sacred space, clean and unclean. The scholars will use terms like holy and common, holy and profane. Holy is that which is connected with God, his space, what he does, objects that are used in his space, and common or profane is stuff that everybody can use. Doesn't matter. It's not, you know, connected with a specific piece of turf. Ritual impurity is about physical defilement that bars one from sacred space or participation. I've mentioned that. Causes and examples. Now I have a quote here from Jonathan Clowens, who's sort of a specialist in ritual, and he's written some really good stuff on it. I really like his material. His line here is, direct or indirect contact with any one of a number of natural processes and substances. The key word here is natural. You can be rendered ritually unclean by just living normal life. It's unavoidable. Specifics. Childbirth renders a woman ritually impure, ritually unclean. A skin or scale disease, genital discharges, whether that is ill health or something normal, doesn't matter, you are ritually impure. Carcasses of certain animals, if you touch them, you are ritually impure, unclean. Human corpses, you don't touch a corpse. Even if you have to bury your dead, go bury your dead, but you're ritually impure. You're ritually unclean. And we're going to talk about what's the logic to some of this stuff in a moment. But again, you get the idea. How long you're impure varies by whatever category it is, whatever circumstance it is, and how you are clean. And cleansing from impurity means, what are the procedures you do so that after a certain period of time, you can participate in the community religiously again? Okay, this has nothing to do with moral violation, offending God in a moral sense. It's about, are you fit to come anywhere close to the presence, okay, to the presence of God in their in the tabernacle temple system. Ritual impurity is natural. It's unavoidable. Hey, guess what? You're going to have babies. You know, you're going to have genital discharges. You're going to get, you know, skin diseases. You're, you know, hey, if you like to eat meat, chances are you're going to touch a carcass when you should. You know, the human corpses. People die, you got to bury. I mean, you just can't avoid these things. Again, there's no moral fault. The system is going to be designed to teach certain things. So it's unavoidable for humans and human circumstances. It usually doesn't arise from moral violation or sin. Okay. Now I mention that because if you read through Leviticus, the cure, the ritual procedure for taking care of ritual uncleanness, it'll say things like, take this bird, take this animal, do this and that, and you shall be cleansed from your sin. Okay, we have to realize that we have a translation problem. The Hebrew word for sin and sin offering, katat, in many circumstances, has nothing to do with moral violation. It actually refers to being decontaminated. And it's about doing something to the person to decontaminate them so that they don't contaminate sacred space. Okay, so many times in your Torah, when you have this sin or sin offering language, it isn't connected at all to moral violation. And I'll go one step further, we're a little ahead of ourselves because we're going to do sacrificial system in a couple of weeks. You may not have noticed, because I know we just, you know, we read all the Leviticus that we can. I know that's like, when can I go back to Leviticus and read that again? The blood of a sacrifice is never applied to the person who brings the sacrifice, ever. It has nothing to do with like cleansing you through the blood. It's never applied to a person. And even when it is applied to any person, there's only two occasions for that, and we'll mention that. One of that was the ceremony to launch the priesthood system. They were just like, okay, well, let's like hit the reset button, everybody's like clean, and then we can get started with this new priesthood thing that God sort of just gave us here at Sinai. It had nothing to do with moral violation. We tend to read words like sin and sin offering in light of the New Testament. No. Don't do that. If you do that, it's not like, you know, you're going to commit some horrible heretical offense. It's just that you won't know what in the world's going on. Okay, you can't read the Old Testament sacrificial system through the lens of New Testament talk about the blood of Jesus. That's one of the primary problems that we have. And, you know, it's easy to do that because we're not Israel. Another quote from Clowns: it is true that the refusal to purify yourself would constitute a transgression, a moral transgression. Let's say I'm an Israelite, I become ritually impure. Man, I don't want to do this. Yeah, that's a heart problem. Okay, if you did that, well, then you got a moral problem going on. Okay, as would coming into contact with the sacred while in a state of impurity. Let's say I know I'm impure, and it's like, okay, God, there. I stepped where I shouldn't. Do something, you know, then it's a heart problem. Okay, if you're dealing with those circumstances, well, there, yeah, then you're going to have a moral issue. But the whole, you know, system doesn't make being ritually impure sinful in and of itself. Moral impurity, on the other hand, okay, we've talked about ritual impurity, now the moral side. There's this other category of moral impurity, and some of these are kind of obvious. You can be morally impure, sexual transgressions, you know, various, you know, laws about sexuality, violating one of those, idolatry is kind of, you know, elementary, bloodshed, you know, murder, okay, something like that. These things that we typically think of as big crimes. Okay, those are moral violations very clearly, and there is a category of moral uncleanness that operates separate from ritual uncleanness. Sometimes they overlap just a little bit, but typically they're separate realms. Now, these are frequently described as abominations. It's not the only term that's used, but if something's an abomination, it's very clearly a moral offense. And again, there's no sacrificial cleansing for a lot of them in the Torah. We'll get to that in a bit. So if you commit a moral offense, there are passages that talk about the person, him or herself, is defiled. The land is defiled. In other words, where these things are tolerated, the land itself, God will look at as though it is in a state of defilement itself, even though it's just dirt. Okay. And then God's sanctuary. This reference in Leviticus 20 is specifically about child sacrifice, Molech. And it says something, I'm paraphrasing now, but it says, you know, if you do this, if you allow this to happen, then God says, you know, my sanctuary will be defiled. Okay, what God means is, I'm not even going to visit you. I'm not going to live here. My sanctuary itself is like polluted by stuff you're doing in the land, if it's this bad. I'm out of here. Okay, this land, the whole land, is no longer fit for my occupation. The land itself is defiled, and the place that I told you to build so that I could visit you and, you know, commune with you and so on and so forth, that's been made dirty by all this. And I'm just not going to be there. So the moral defilement was pretty serious. It even extended, you know, to these other things. Corporately, Leviticus 18 actually spends a lot of time talking about this, and Leviticus 26 does as well. That if there's enough of this going on, God said, I will expel you from the land. In other words, I'm not going to show up here because the whole country, the whole land is polluted. So the solution to that is to kick you out. And if you're gone long enough, well, then maybe I'll come back here. Maybe it will be fit for my occupation. So there are all sorts of warnings about not persisting in this kind of thing because you'll be expelled. Of course, when the exile happens, the prophets go and they quote passages like this and say, like, duh, didn't you people realize what was going to happen to you if you did this, that, and the other thing? Now here's kind of a summary. You've got ritual and moral impurity. Source, again, natural things. The effect is temporary defilement, temporary impurity. And the it's contagious. Ritual impurity is the one that if I'm ritually impure, like I touch a dead body, I'm in a state of ritual uncleanness. If I touch you, oh, the cooties just got passed on. You're ritually impure now. That isn't the case if I'm just wicked. I go out and kill somebody, and I can, you know, touch you all I want. You're not rendered unclean by that. But if it's ritual impurity, you are. So there, it's again, it's a totally different kind of system. The effect of the moral is frankly worse. Desecration of a person, a land, the sanctuary, the whole bit. And then the resolution, there are different rituals that involve bathing and then waiting periods. Here, Clowens lists atonement or punishment and ultimately exile. By atonement, he's referring to restitution, which we'll get to in another week. But moral defilement defiles the sinner, land, and sanctuary, not anyone with which he comes into contact. Ritual impurity is like a contagion, moral impurity is not. There's nothing that you, you know, if you commit adultery, commit murder, you know, you're an idolater. Hey, that ain't going away by taking a bath. Okay. There's a different set of penalties for that. That's not going away. You know, the solution for that kind of, you know, impurity is punishment. You either are put to death or you're exiled from the community. Now, the word for that in Torah is the person shall be cut off from his people. And scholars fight over, well, is that also the death penalty, or is that just you're kicked out of the community and don't ever come back? It's probably the latter, but you'll see that debate. Some crimes, some moral crimes, involve restitution. If I steal, again, that ain't going away with a little water bath and a waiting period. What I have to do is I do have to bring a sacrifice so I can be purged. I can be decontaminated from what I've done, but I also have to pay restitution to the person who suffered loss. Okay, so there's a little bit of an overlap between the ritual and the moral there. And then abstinence. I mean, you can cure this by just not doing that stuff, which of course is, you know, what the leadership would want. By way of summary, since moral impurity does not produce ritual defilement, sinners, in contrast to those who are ritually impure, are not excluded from the sanctuary. Isn't that odd? So if I'm a murderer, if I'm still alive, if I went on holy ground, I didn't defile them. Because I'm not, my problem isn't ritual impurity, it's moral impurity. So see, you actually had like murderers run into the sanctuary. You know, there's a couple of accounts in this in the Old Testament. They didn't defile the sanctuary because the Torah said that their moral crime doesn't defile ritually. It's just a moral problem. And, you know, they were trying to, you know, they're not going to get me in here because that would be shedding of blood. Of course, that didn't work out too well for some of the people who tried it. But that was the thinking. Numbers 5, the so-called, you know, test for adultery, they bring the woman into the sanctuary. Well, if they assume, and some of them are thinking, yeah, she's probably guilty, why would they bring her into the sanctuary? Well, the answer is because that's not going to pollute the sanctuary. It's a moral problem. It's not a ritual problem. So again, this seems kind of odd to us, but they have these two categories, and they know what to plunk in each category. On those occasions where moral impurity does defile the sanctuary, like again, some of that stuff we talked about with Moloch, it's not because a sinner is brought into the sanctuary, it's because of what happens in there. Moloch case would be idolatry. So that's more of an issue. Now, there's a long quote here, and I want to read it to you because it's kind of interesting. Clowens again, he says, "We're dealing with perceived effects that result from actual physical processes. In the case of ritual impurity, a real physical process or event, such as somebody dying or menstruation, loss of blood or whatever, has a perceived effect. It's an impermanent contagion that affects people and certain objects within their reach. In the case of moral impurity, a real physical process or event, such as child sacrifice or adultery, has a different perceived effect, a non-contagious defilement that affects persons, the land, and the sanctuary. In both cases, the impurity can be conveyed. Ritual impurity is conveyed by direct and indirect human contact. Moral impurity is conveyed to the land by sins that take place on it. And through the land, the impurity is conveyed to the sanctuary. That's why God has to leave. In both cases, moreover, there are practical legal ramifications that result from the impurity. The ritually impure person must keep away from sacred things, and in some cases, they're barred from certain precincts, sacred space. The morally impure person may be subject to capital punishment, or in the case of unwitting female partners to sexual misconduct, permanent degradation and fewer options for marriage. You know, where the innocent party wouldn't be, you know, under the death penalty, but again, in the system, there are going to be, you know, consequences to that. When the land has been defiled to a great extent, its people are exiled. So that's kind of a summary of the two categories. Now, here's where we kind of want to camp tonight. What in the world's the logic to all this? Why do you have the two categories? Why did in the one, like, let's just take one of them, in the ritual impurement, or ritual impurity, why do some of those things, why were they considered to contaminate someone, to make them ineligible to be near God or to, you know, occupy sacred space? What's the point? You know, you got bodily flows, contact with the dead, childbirth, all this. What's the point? Now, I'm going to give you, I think it's either 4 or 5. And again, these are sort of the best attempts at consensus. There's no one approach that really explains everything in the Torah in these two categories. Taken collectively, you can pretty much account for everything. And there are a few outliers, and scholars are typically like, well, you know, we got like 98% of this sort of explained, but there's this other thing over here that I don't know. You know, you're still up against that, but there are some broad principles that really, like, sort of capture the logic. All of them are going to have to do with binary opposition. In other words, they are what they are to teach a binary opposition between us and God. There's a clear differentiation. Life is associated with God, death is not. Blood, semen, skin diseases. Okay, if we take life versus death, this is a broad category. If you look at, like, the bodily fluids that render someone unfit for sacred space, what do blood and semen, you know, have in common? They are associated with life. If you lose enough blood, you're going to die. So they don't have to be medical scholars to know that, hey, that red stuff that comes out of your body, you got to keep that in your body or you're going to die. So the loss of blood is sort of like moving toward death. And to teach the idea that, you know, God is associated with life, death is not associated with God, the loss of blood renders you unfit for sacred space, and that is supposed to reinforce that lesson. Wholeness, having all your blood, okay, that is associated with life, and life is associated with God. So if I lose blood, then I have to do this ritual. I got to wait a certain number of days. Nobody's wanting, there's no Israelite guys going around taking your blood count like with some instrument, okay? We're not talking about anything technological. It's just to reinforce an idea. If you have, you know, without being too graphic, you have a seminal emission at night, or you have sex, okay? As a man, you have lost the life-giving fluid, that thing which produces life. That makes you ritually impure for a while. Not so that somebody, you know, like the Israelite doctor can take a sperm count later on, okay, with his fancy medical instruments. It has nothing to do with it. The idea is that you need to realize that any loss of life, any loss of the life force, cannot be associated with the presence of God, because God is life. It's a simple object lesson. Sounds kind of weird to our ear, but you know, you do that often enough, people are going to get the point. This is associated with life. Life is associated with God. If I lose the life force, then I am not fit to be on sacred space, because God is life. Okay? So you have a broad sort of, you know, categorization there. Skin diseases, there's a passage in Leviticus that describes skin disease as that the person is, their skin is reminiscent of a corpse. Mm-hmm. Okay, and so the association, the visual association of that skin disease with a dead body is enough to make it a teaching point. You have a skin disease, it looks like you're deteriorating, deterioration, death. That is, we can't have that on sacred space, because God is not associated with deterioration and death. So we have to take care of that. Different procedures for doing that. It's Numbers 12:12. Let her not be like a corpse. This is when Miriam gets punished with leprosy. Let her not be like a corpse. It was associated with, she's decaying and dying. And it made her, you know, unclean, and some of these other things. Another idea is imitation of God's nature. So one rationale is binary opposition of life and death. Explains some of the ideas. Number two idea is some of these laws only make sense if the person who undergoes them is sort of viewed as imitating God in some way. That sounds really weird, but this one's actually kind of interesting. Sex is one of the places that scholars camp on for this idea. Why does sex make us unfit for sacred space? The answer is because it's being unlike God. Does that mean sex is bad? No, God made it and said, be fruitful and multiply. It's unlike God because God is eternal. He doesn't need to reproduce. He has no beginning. He has no end. Because God has no consort, he has no wife, you know, in Israelite thinking, God cannot have sex. Therefore, Fry Murkensky is, she's passed away now, but she was a scholar of ritual studies. As she puts it, in order to approach God, one has to leave the sexual realm. By separating sex from death, is by following the ritual purity regulations, ancient Israelites, and especially ancient Israelite priests and Levites, separated themselves from what made them the least God-like. In other words, the point of following these regulations is nothing other than the theological underpinning of the entire holiness code, the imitation of God. So, you're eligible to enter the sanctuary if you are in a God-like state. If you have sex, you're disqualified for two reasons. You've lost the life force, and you're not imitating God, because God doesn't need to reproduce. So all, you know, sort of the correct sexual behaviors, even those will render you ritually impure. Because of this idea. God does not die. He does not need to reproduce. In his presence is life. God does not have sex because he is eternal. So if you want to serve as a priest, you can't have sex for X number of days before your job obligations. If you do, then you can't do that. Because to enter sacred space and perform your duty, you have to be like a divine proxy. You're a substitute, you know, for God's presence. You were selected, in this case, because you're from a certain tribe, you were selected to be a stand-in, to occupy sacred space, to do certain things in the presence of God. And to do that, you have to be God-like. So again, it sounds really weird to our ear. Think about how, you know, I'm sure Dax is like, you know, man, you know, the way we go through the rest of the list, you know, because it's like, do I really have to like jump through all these hoops just to have church? Well, thankfully, no. You know, but if you're in the Israelite system, there are all these ways of circumscribing your behavior, good behavior, normal behavior. Because by doing that, you teach people what God is like. But this space over here is different than the space I'm in. God's presence is over here. It's not here. I'm okay over here. But to go over there, I have to be in special circumstances or special condition or a special person, you know, from a specific tribe. And I can't have done this, that, and the other thing for X number of days. It's to distinguish between who God is and who you are, who we are. And you do that by rendering certain places sacred, certain objects sacred. You don't touch them. You don't even go near them. And even if you're allowed to go near them, let's go down the checklist and see if you're eligible. You know, you have all these hoops you have to jump through. Third category, some have argued, and the example again is kind of gross or weird, but it's still part of Torah, that there's an issue of controllable versus uncontrollable. Now, Collins is quoting another scholar here, and the issue, believe it or not, is, well, I'll just start. It's precisely with this regard, to this point, that the work of Eilbert Schwartz is important, noting the conundrum that the routine seminal discharge, Leviticus 15, is less problematized than general discharges of blood, Leviticus 15, or flux, also 15. Albert Schwartz introduces the criterion of controllability in the discussion of the meaning of ritual purity. Without denying the importance of the notions of sex and death, Albert Schwartz suggests that controllability may play a role in determining which substances defile and how severely they defile. Briefly stated, he argues that the less a process or an event can be controlled, the more likely it is to defile. And he uses the example of excrement, poop. Okay, there are actually laws about poop in the Torah. And they can't really be accounted for in the other two, the life versus death thing, although some would argue that what you excrete is the opposite of life because your body doesn't use it. Okay, so you might be able to get some of that in there. But tears and saliva, okay, why is that okay? You know, because their excretion is subject to human control. These substances were not considered defiling in ancient Israel. On the other hand, menstrual blood, non-seminal general discharge are among the most defiling substances since they are the least subject to human control. You know, so again, when this third category is conceived, we're trying to pick up like, okay, what's the logic with tears and saliva and poop? And you know, why does this thing that I discharge from my body, that makes me ritually impure, but this other one doesn't? They're trying to figure out a holistic approach to this. So third option is controllable versus uncontrollable. Now here's the one we often think of, food or dietary laws. And this, you can go part of the way with some of the things we've already discussed. Let's just take the life and death thing. It's very clear that animals that eat dead animals, carrion eaters, those will render you unclean. Okay, you don't eat those. So there's this life-death connection. Okay, you can't really get this be God-like connection or control. It doesn't really work. And then there's some oddities. And we're not going to go through the whole list, but we've got flying animals, eating unclean insects, land animals, water animals. And there's no unifying principle that explains why everything is on either side. And so this one is kind of problematic. we'll do the park on which animals here. Traditional explanations have been, well, this is all about hygiene. Again, there are problems. There are some clear instances where, yeah, okay, it might be about hygiene because this animal is kind of, pardon the pun, piggish, okay? You know, like the pig is always the easy target here. But there are other animals that, well, they're not like pigs. I mean, they're not unusually dirty. You know, why are they excluded? So there's a bit of a disconnect there. Some say, well, the ones that are forbidden have some association with cults, like religious cults in Israel at the time that other, you know, the Gentiles were doing. There are some clear ones for that. But then there are other ones that, well, hey, we offer that animal too, and so do the Canaanites. What's up with that? Why is that one clean for us since they're killing all the goats all the time? Maybe why aren't goats unclean because they do it? You know, there just doesn't seem to be a unifying logic to it. Moral and ethical, again, some people, you know, try to sort of interject or retroject, you know, like environmentalism on it. You know, that certain animals are, you know, off limits because you have to control their populations and it's good for the ecosystem. And again, there are always exceptions to every approach, and so that's why it's a problem. Now, Mary Douglas is a famous ritual scholar. If you actually do any academic reading on Leviticus, you will run into her name. She's pretty important. Not everybody agrees with her, but she's still pretty important. She writes, the pattern, she thinks it's about patterns of opposition, especially inclusion and exclusion. Seen in the social structures of a society, its cult, that's its ritual system. Its view of the body and its classification of animals may be expected to correspond to and confirm one another. So she's saying we might just have these oppositions because they might derive kind of unconsciously, or just, unconscious is not a good word, they might just have arisen intuitively in Israelite or, you know, ancient patriarchal culture. Because there are certain laws in the Torah that are also found in other law codes, like, you know, Hammurabi's law code, you remember that from History of Sin, okay? You're gonna get laws that show up there that show up in Torah. And that's just one law code. There's hundreds of law codes, and there's overlap between the Israelite law code, the Torah, and a lot of those. And so a lot of people, and I would be in this camp, would say a lot of what goes on in Torah is that when God prompted, you know, when he started working with the Israelites, when he prompted the writing of this or that book, there's already a culture in place. God doesn't have to, like, invent one and say, well, this is the Israelite culture now. No, he just takes people where they are and then wants certain laws done to, you know, control crime and punishment and whatnot. Maybe be more tolerant than the Hittites are or something like that. That God works with a culture already in place. And so Douglas argues that, you know, a lot, maybe this, these binary oppositions, this clean and unclean, maybe it's just sort of intuitive. Maybe, again, it's not a perfect system either. I'll give you one example of, there are a lot of people who beat on the Bible because of the Zelophehad incident. Anybody know who Zelophehad is? With a gold star for the night. She's the woman that has to go to Moses after her husband dies and she doesn't have sons, and ask if she's allowed to have her husband's property. There are no laws permitting female inheritance of land in the Torah. Why is that? Because the biblical characters are sexist. They're evil, sexist pigs. Look, you know, again, God didn't, you know, prompt anybody to write that down. It was just part of the Israelite culture. And Moses says, hey, you know, you're right. We're going to let her have that land. But there wasn't a Torah law. They had to actually go to Moses for an opinion, for a ruling, because it's not part of Torah. It's just part of the wider culture. And Moses says, give her the land. But people love to beat on the Bible for stuff like that. But what's the basis? Again, it may just not, again, it may be just cultural, maybe arbitrary, but it's still intentional, because no matter what the logic was that produced the clean and unclean animals, once the clean and unclean columns are filled, it still teaches the same thing. You eat these, but you don't eat those. Well, why? You know, to be honest, because this is the way God wants it to be. even though we can't figure out exactly a reason why everything is on the list, because like this other stuff that has to do with bodily fluids and, you know, going this place and that place and doing this ritual and that ritual, it teaches you that you have to live a certain way to be fit to occupy sacred space, to be part of the sacred community, which is Israel, to be part of God's family. Okay, you have to conform to what God wants, because you're not like God. God is different than you. God's bigger and better than you. He gets to make these rules, and he wants to see if you are willing to give up maybe eating something that you really kind of like to eat or you'd like to try. Okay, are you willing to give that up to be part of the community? Maybe it's just that simple. Maybe there doesn't have to be an overriding logic to it. Here's another question. What about parts of clean animals? You actually have this. You have parts of clean animals that they still can't eat. How does that make any sense? Well, if you look at the parts, there are certain instances where they're not allowed to consume blood, which is pretty general. Why aren't the people allowed to consume blood? Because the life is in the blood. Because you're assuming, you're intaking something, you're ingesting something that belongs to God in sacrifice, or should be spilt out on sacred space, which is God's, because God is the author of life. It's just, again, it's just designed to teach an idea, to teach an association. Doesn't have to do with hygiene, doesn't have to do with calorie count, okay? It's life is life belongs connected to the life giver. It is not for you, it's for God. So you get blood burned up on the altar, you're gonna drained in sacred space. Even when they take the blood, they'll sprinkle the tabernacle or different objects. What will they do with the rest of it? They'll pour it out at the base of the altar. It's still on sacred space, because life belongs to God. It doesn't belong to you, it belongs to God. It's the same thing with the fat. Fat, even of clean animals, and probably because it retains a lot of blood too. You know, you're only allowed to do certain things with it. The sciatic nerve, this is the Jacob story, you know, when he wrestles with the angel. You know, why is that forbidden? Probably because of the Jacob story. It's associated with divine encounter. So to remember the divine encounter, we don't eat that part. Okay, it's just a simple idea. Carrion, that has to do with life or life and death opposition. That one's pretty easy. But the fat and the blood, again, are a little odd, because you have to think conceptually of what is reserved for God's consumption and what is reserved for human consumption. Sometimes you're allowed to, if you're a priest, again, you're the God proxy. If you're a priest, you're allowed to consume certain, you know, parts of the fat, participate in the sacrificial meal, other times you're not. If you're not a priest, well, you can just pretty much forget that. Other examples, you know, the famous or infamous kid boiled in its mother's milk, oh, why? Is that some have proposed it's a humanitarian law. You know, we shouldn't, it's cruel to take a baby goat, we'll say, and kill it, and then boil it in its own mother's milk. That's just evil. That's just wicked. And so some will say that it's a humanitarian law. Maybe. Some say it's associated with a specific cult practice. Some people tried to tie that into some ritual text from Ugarit. It doesn't work real well, but people try it. There is some evidence, though, in iconography, which is sculpture, pictures, art, Polaroids of the day, to call them, where you have this motif, a mother animal with a suckling calf that appears on cult objects. And so there may be something, it may have something to do with Gentile religious practices. The real answer is nobody knows for sure why it is, but these are the approaches. Now, that's what I wanted to cover next, or this time we can take some questions, but all this is tied to sacred space, why certain areas are what they are, and objects are what they are. Now, just to prep a few things for next time. This is going to take us into the concept of holiness. Have you ever wondered why inanimate objects are called holy. This is why. You only use that object to do this thing at that place. Otherwise, you are not allowed to use it. And you say, well, who cares? Like, why is that bad? Who gives a rip? See, we have lost, and I'm not ratting on the way we do church in the modern era. But if you've ever been in a really, really, really liturgical church, they still have some sense of this. Okay, you don't, unless you're like ordained as a priest, unless you're wearing a funny hat and lots of robes. You don't go to the front of the church, and you don't go through the little doors where the priest blesses the communion stuff. You don't go there. In fact, the church is designed with a little gate there deliberately. It's not just, hey, we watched an HGTV show, and we kind of like that feature. No, it's there so that when you see a gate, it's like, oh, I'm not supposed to go through the gate. Because beyond that, that's what the priest, that's where he does his thing. It's to remind you that certain places in the sanctuary, interesting term, okay, are off limits. Why? Because that guy thinks he's holier than I am? No, it's just to enforce the idea that we come here to do God stuff. And that's the guy who does the God stuff. Because he's a minister, he's a priest, he's a whatever, you know, whatever the title is. You know, in Israel, it's they're just the whole nine yards doing that. Okay, you were not supposed to tread on certain places. You were not supposed to touch, much less use, certain objects. We only use that cup one day a year, or every this or that ritual. And only the priest can touch that cup. Why? Because the priest thinks he's better than I am? No. It's to reinforce the idea that in life there are sacred things and non-sacred things. God is different. You want to treat him like he is different. Where God lives should be treated like it's significant. It's not normal. Because God isn't normal. It's not common, because God isn't common. These are simple ideas. And in the case of Torah, it's just all over the place. But since we don't grow up with temple, in evangelicalism, you know, we have communion, you know, we got Christmas and Easter, but you know, our religious calendar is abbreviated compared to a ritualistic system. I mean, in Israel, you got Sabbath, you got stuff to do on Sabbath, you got collections of Sabbaths, you know, cycles of Sabbaths, then you've got Jubilees, then you got cycles of Jubilees, you got this festival, that festival. Everything is in order. And some of the priests, you know, we'll talk about this in the fourth week, some of them were like, I want to say nutcases, but that's harsh. Some of them were just, they were willing to die for what day we hold this thing on. And there's a reason for that. It's a set of ideas that they attached to keeping the calendar. Why it was so important. We've lost pretty much all sense of that. And part of it is because of the New Testament. Where is sacred space now? You're looking at, look around, okay? This is why, you know, I'm not saying it's a bad thing to be liturgical. In some ways, I mean, when we were in Wisconsin, we went to a church that had an order of service. I'm trying to remember what the terminology they used for it. Order of service. It wasn't terribly liturgical or ritual, but they had enough of it that it made you kind of stop and think of where you were at. Like in this, you know, and that was kind of nice. But the reality is, it's okay not to do that. Because the building isn't where sacred space is unless a bunch of us are there. Okay, because we are the temple. We are sacred space. The whole system changes. So after centuries of embodying sacred space, who are the priests now? That would be the same thing. Same answer to that. Priesthood of the believer is a concept in the New Testament. Every believer is a priest. Every believer is sacred space. So theologically, you know, these things have changed. And so it's really tough for us to look back on the Old Testament when they didn't have any of that. They had to do this so that they could draw near to the throne of grace. You don't just assume as an Israelite that you're okay to go worship God. Well, God knows my heart. God knows that I, you know, touched that carcass the other day and I'm supposed to bring this, and you know, he'll let me off the hook here because I'm doing the right thing. Actually, he won't. You know, we assume certain liberties because of Jesus. This is why the language in Hebrews mimics this, but it substitutes Jesus all the time. And it applies the rules to every believer everywhere the believer is. It's not linked to a plot of ground anymore. Hebrews 9, the blood of bulls and goats cannot take away sin. Well, you look back in Leviticus and it says, if you do this, your sin is forgiven. Why? The Bible's a contradiction. And, the atheist, you know, another dumb argument from atheist city. No, it's actually true. All these rituals weren't about curing moral violation. If you committed a moral offense, an abomination, there's no sacrifice for you. You're either put to death or exiled from the community. So the writer of Hebrews actually knows what he's talking about. The blood of bulls and goats doesn't take care of these problems. Okay, which is the whole point that, you know, Jesus' death actually does take care of these problems. That's why it's better. That's why the writer of Hebrews says you're insane if you want to go back to that. Like, do you even understand what you're talking about? Oh, I'd rather be exiled or put to death if I happen to make one of these boo-boos. I mean, you're nuts. Okay, that's in the Greek somewhere. You're nuts. Okay. There's a point to the logic and the superiority system. So, anybody have any questions? And we'll get into some of the tabernacle stuff and the sacrificial system in the weeks to come. But I know it's just strange. It's just a totally different way of looking at things.
In 1 Corinthians 7:5, talking about sex, Paul says, do not deprive one another, except perhaps by agreement for a limited time that you may devote yourselves to prayer, but then come together again. Are these sort of the ideas that he's...
Yeah, I mean, look at Paul. Who's Paul? He's a Pharisee. I mean, he obviously knows the law pretty well. And it's this idea that you know, and he's speaking generally. I mean, it's Corinthians, so it's including Gentiles here too. But it's the idea that you set this aside for a spiritual purpose, you know, voluntarily. You have to agree, okay, to do that. But the logic is the same, that we're not going to do X, Y, or Z so that we can focus over here. Now the effect, since we don't have, you know, temples and stuff like this in the New Testament era, it's not going to make you any more of a God proxy than you already are if you have the Spirit in you. But the idea of sort of getting that spiritual tunnel vision for a while is what he's shooting at.
So would it then, I kind of look back, you know, during that time, that sex is far more, you know, recreational. It's what they had to do as well, you know what I mean, during that time. They didn't go home and put on Netflix or something like that. Could you make that same application?
And they had larger families, too, because it was just the way the culture
was. That's what they did. So would you say it's the same thing? I mean, should we then, you know, at times look to sacrifice those things that we might devote ourselves to, holier things?
Yeah, I think fasting, you know, like using that as an example of fasting, not just not eating, that gets at it. Okay. And you can fast from almost everything.
And that's reasonable.
Right? Yeah.
Do you think, given this framework of understanding sort of the two categories, if you will, of violating sacred space or of moral impurity but also ritual impurity, how does that apply to us as believers who are sacred space? Like, are there ways that we ritually can be unclean? Or?
Well, what's the language Paul repeats? Well, it's not just Paul, but he repeatedly uses believers. You are
saints.
Yes, but you also are The temple. We're referred to as, you know, temple stones. We're referred to as temples. Consistently. You know, I'll just fire a little shot here. And again, this isn't aimed at anybody's eschatology. I just want you to think about it, you know, more broadly. We spend so much time thinking about the temple that's going to be built someday in Israel. And we kind of skip the temple talk of the New Testament. The temple talk of the New Testament starts with Jesus. Okay, and Jesus says, in 3 days I will raise this temple up. And the Pharisees go, it took us all these years to build this. Who are you? You're kind of a lunatic. And John says, no, he spoke of the temple, which is his body. Now, we can like think that's kind of a throwaway scene, but the temple is Jesus' body. The temple is the body of Christ. We are the body of Christ post-resurrection. All of these things loop together. They're not random statements. And again, that doesn't mean that, you know, we're not going to have some eschatological temple somewhere. It's just we're so fixated on that language that we miss New Testament temple language all over the place. Now, if we have time on the last week, there's just some crazy stuff going on, like in Ezekiel 40 through 48. Everybody looks at that passage and thinks only of a building in the future. There are almost 70 references, the numbers that are used in Ezekiel 40 through 48. There are almost 70 numerals there that are multiples of Jubilee numbers. Okay. What's the passage Jesus quotes when he begins his ministry in Nazareth? It's Isaiah 61. Go read the first few verses. And then the language about healing the broken heart, you know, all this kind of stuff. Look at where that occurs in the Torah. It's Leviticus. It's a Jubilee passage. If you plot out the chronology of the life of Jesus, the year that he begins his ministry is a Jubilee year. Okay. He walks into the synagogue of Nazareth in a Jubilee year. He quotes a Jubilee passage and says, this day, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. He wasn't kidding. He's like, I got to come up with a good line. It's my first sermon. Something memorable. No, he's not kidding. But we just sort of fly right over them. Is Jesus the eschatological temple? Again, 70 Jubilee references in Ezekiel 40 through 48. Well, he was. The temple was his body. His body was the temple. And the temple is the body of Christ, and that would be us. Okay, all these things fit together. Isn't that kind of weird? No, it actually really isn't. I mean, it's kind of like right there hidden in plain sight. But we don't think about these things because we have a hard time thinking abstractly like this, both because of who we are. You know, we're modern. We're nuts and bolts. We're scientific. You know, we're rationalists. We're part of the Enlightenment culture. You know, we're just not used to thinking abstractly, and I'll use the dirty word here, non-literally. Like biblical people were. Because we're kind of taught when we see a word, we just assign its meaning is the first thing that pops into our head literally. Well, it might be. There's a lot of that in the Bible. Might not be too. It might hook into something that is just, you know, like just way abstract that an Israelite or a Jew would go, I know what he's talking about there. Because they just, this is more intuitive to them. It's not intuitive to us. Both because of what we are, kind of the way we're taught to approach Scripture, we have these sort of roadblocks that get in the way of reading it through their eyes. It's really hard. You know, it's hard to do. One of the best things you can do, I don't want this to become, you know, Mike's, you know, laws for Bible study here, but one of the best things you can do, it's going to sound trivial, look up the cross references. You know, when the printer printed your Bible, he didn't just have like white space in the middle and say, I don't know what to put there. It's just going to screw up the page count. What do I do? What do I do? I'm going to put verses in there. Just throw verses in there. That'll fill up the space. No, they're actually there for a reason. The typesetting in your Bible is different when the Old Testament's being quoted. Did you know that? That's a printing decision. They do that to draw your eye to, oh, they're quoting the Old Testament. I wonder where that is. And you go look in the cross references and you go read that. If you do that all the time, then, you know, it's easier to connect dots. It's just, it's a habit that's formed. You know, patterns. How do the New Testament writers use the Old Testament? They use it all the time. And they use it in some really kind of weird abstract ways. But again, that's, use it as a teaching device, you know, for Bible study. All that stuff's there to make use of. Well, I know my Bible really well. I don't need to use those cross references. Come on. You don't know it that well. you don't know it that well. None of us do. Anybody else?
When you were talking about sex defiling, I thought back of where David went to the priest to see if he had anything his men could eat, and
yeah.
All he had was the holy bread.
Yeah.
And he said the only possibility is that the guys have been kept from women
for
a certain period.
Yeah.
He assured me they were kept away for 3 days, so
right,
must
so
be
that,
okay.
Right, that's his link to rationalize this. But it's a good illustration.
Because yeah.
The priest is sort of looking for some justification, you know, for that. It's like, okay, you know, we'll give you the bread you're not supposed to eat as long as your men don't violate this, you know, this other rule. So it kind of washes out in the end. Yeah, that's a good illustration.
So this might be a kind of a rabbit trail, but the priests not having sex, is that why the Catholic Church, why their priests do not, you know, can't marry and don't, aren't supposed to have?
You know, I think if you read deeply enough in Catholic thought, the answer to that would probably be no, because the priests weren't prevented from marrying. They were prevented in Israel. You know, Israelite priests could be married. And you might have part of the Catholic argument sort of hook into what we're talking about tonight to make their decision of celibacy holier. But typically they're going to look at things like they're gonna kind of model it after, you know, Jesus. Jesus wasn't married. Some of it's gonna be a little more, you know, historically conditioned. They're gonna look for some sort of templated model like that, because the Old Testament priesthood could marry, but I think it's conceivable that they could say, well, look, this is special, and you know, we're gonna go, you know, the nth degree here, and we're not gonna marry. Like, Jesus isn't married. Look at the priests here. This may be a little more, you know, sanctified in certain times. So I think you'd probably run into it, but I don't think it's the major, you know, argument.
Maybe Paul, where he said, "Yeah, it's better that you're single like I am." Except that first pope had a mother-in-law, so that
it does mess it up. But they'll deny that too. Paul's status is a little ambiguous, you know. But if you're a Catholic and you come down on Paul being unmarried, which is a possibility, then you'd have some leverage there too. Paul may have been divorced. He may have been deserted by his wife. We just don't really know. He just says, when he's talking about being unmarried, which is, write this down, the state of being spouseless. Then he gets into that, I wish that all men were like, you know, I was. Then he goes into some pragmatic reasons for it. But the unmarried term there occurs only four times in the New Testament. They're all in that chapter. And so it's 1 Corinthians 7. So the real issue, this gets into the divorce and marriage issue too. If agameo, the state of being spouseless, can we, here's the key question for that passage as it relates to divorce and remarriage, and ostensibly or peripherally, this question. On what exegetical basis do we exclude divorce from the list of conditions that make you spouseless? In other words, is divorce included in 1 Corinthians 7's references to being unmarried? Is it or isn't it? Depending on what you think there, you're going to take later statements like Paul's in a certain light. You're going to take right around verse 27 or so when Paul says, you know, if you're loose from a wife, you know, don't seek to be bound. If you're bound, don't seek to be loosed. Nevertheless, hey, you know, it's basically, it's if you marry, you don't sin. So when he says, if you marry, you don't sin, is he talking to divorced people too? Because he's talking about people who are loosed. You know, the ultimate answer is, well, who really knows for sure? And the answer to that is nobody.
I suppose it could be death as well.
Right. Death would count it. I mean, how many ways can you be spouses? Desertion, divorce, death. It's not really the state of being an unmarried virgin, because there's a separate word in the passage for that. But, you know, that could conceivably be part of a bigger list. How do we know what Paul was thinking of and not thinking of? Or is he thinking of the whole list or just a couple? And we just don't know. That's why it's a tough issue. That's why it's difficult. And if Corinthians was written before Matthew was written, it gets even more complicated, because then Paul doesn't have Jesus thinking to refer back to it, which is why he never quotes Matthew in 1 Corinthians 7. Now, what do you do with that? Well, you do with that what we've always done with it, and that's argue about it. So, that's pretty much where we're at, you know. Who knows? But anyway, well, I don't want to keep everybody over, so thanks for coming. See you next week. We'll talk about